Hey, we're here on Land Beat, and we're in southwest Missouri on a native prairie, and we're talking about one of the three primary components that quail have to have, and that's woody cover. You know, we're looking at this awesome plum thicket and talking about how important it is for quail, but for a lot of folks, this doesn't exist on their property.
That's right, that's right. And it's really easy to establish nesting cover. It's really easy to establish brood rearing cover. That's herbaceous stuff that comes on pretty quickly. Shrubs can often be slow growing. And luckily on this site, this particular clump of American plum was naturally occurring on this site. And so we didn't have to do anything to establish this. But a landowner may have to establish shrubs on their property if they don't have the adequate woody cover on their property. They may have to establish shrubs or some kind of shrub surrogate that will approximate a shrub or help fill in that gap until your shrubs have grown up.
Yeah, just, you know, we need to let people know we're in southwest Missouri here, and this is a native prairie. So the species that you're seeing behind us, this stuff's been here for thousands of years, and these thickets as well. This native prairie evolved with dogwood thickets and plum thickets and sumac thickets. But yeah, a lot of times we're not on native, and most of the time we're not on native prairies, right? We're dealing with CRP ground or crop ground or old fields or just whatever when we're on different landowners' properties. So there's several ways that we can do this. Obviously, direct planting. We can plant shrubs. It's going to take years to fully develop into a thicket, and you're going to have to protect that. I can assure you that, you know, every plan we write, whether it's for deer, turkeys, quail, it's going to involve prescribed fire.
Right.
Well, you're going to have to protect those plantings for several years to get up to where they're fire tolerant.
Right.
But there's a lot of other ways that we
can create. So one of the things that we recommend often is down tree structures. And so think about some trees that you have on your property that aren't doing you any good for wildlife habitat. Oftentimes what we'll do is we'll recommend cutting those trees down and dragging them out into the open to serve as a surrogate shrub. And so those treetops will sort of serve the purpose of woody cover. And then what will happen is you can sometimes plant within that, and that gives you some protection from browsing. But also over time, birds will land in there, they'll defecate, they'll drop seeds, and you'll get a shrub planting or a shrub growth right out of that down tree structure. Down tree structures are really good. Often we use cedars, but really any tree that we don't want on the landscape that we can afford to take down, we'll drag out into the field, and it'll serve as a surrogate woody cover.
Yeah, and you know, it's important to mention too, we don't need trees for quail management, okay? They don't use trees. There's no reason for them to be here. We need shrubs. We don't have to have trees. So lots of times, short term, we might have a thicket that's coming along. Mm-hmm. We have one right here that has some persimmons it's functioning like a shrub thicket for the moment, but eventually those are going to keep growing. Either we've got to burn it and top kill those to keep them in a low growing form, or we're going to have to do something different because eventually those will grow into trees.
Yeah.
And that's not what we want. They'll lose their effectiveness. The ground cover, herbaceous cover will start filling in underneath. Quail can't move around.
Right.
There's another factor to scattered trees out here that we don't like as well. We did some raccoon research.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Touch on that.
Yeah, what we found with the raccoon research is that the raccoons were very attracted to trees, mostly tree rows or along linear fence rows or along a drainage way that had a tree row. The coons were really attracted to that. But even scattered trees out on the landscape, they would use for escape cover. So imagine you're out on this prairie landscape and you're a raccoon. You're looking out for your predators, right? So bobcats or coyotes that may prey on you, you want to have a ready escape route. And so that's why they tended to stay on these prairie landscapes around tree rows or riparian areas. But on other landscapes where there was trees scattered out, they would travel the whole area and be subject to find more and more quail nests or more turkey nests because they had escape routes everywhere they looked, right? And so that speaks to the management of woody cover on your property that sometimes trees, all the times trees for bobwhites in this case, can be detrimental. And so we want to use things, get rid of those, not only for the aerial predation, but also coons can readily jump up in them.
Well, and take it a step further. So, you know, Frank and I were involved with some quail research, lots of radio collars, big data set, 1,500 radio collared quail. And what we discovered was the closer to shrubs, the better survival. But the closer to trees, mature trees, the lower the survival of both broods and adult birds. So trees are detrimental to quail. Shrubs are a positive influence to their survival. So it goes hand in hand. We have to have both. You know, another, we talked about down tree structures, and we do that a lot where we need to on both private lands and public lands that we manage. Edge feathering, same exact thing. We're just not physically moving those trees. We go along a mature edge and we edge feather. Birds will deposit, you know, some seeds out of some of that, and it'll develop into that nice shrubby transition into the timbered edge.
Yeah.
There's several different ways to go about it.
Right. And that also speaks to shrub management. So once you get a shrub plot established or a clump of shrubs established, or you've got a native clump that's already on your property, you can't just sit back and say, well, I got my shrubs, and then leave it alone. Because eventually what will happen, especially if you're from the Midwest east, and we get 44 inches of rain here, and as you go further east, you get more rain, what's going to happen is you'll eventually get trees that grow up in these thickets. And what you want to do is come in and cut those trees down. Sometimes these plum thickets will actually become too tall and too sparse underneath to serve their purpose. And in those cases, we'll go in there and actually cut some of the plums down, let them stump sprout and regenerate, and get a fresh new growth of plums that serves the purposes that we want for bobwhite protection. So shrub plantings do require some management. They're not just an establish and then forget about them.
And one last thought, you know, the nice thing about them when you burn through them, and we burn a lot, these native shrubs have the ability to top kill but immediately stump sprout, so they can replace themselves, where some less fire tolerant species aren't going to put up with that, you know, type of management. So it's really important when we are establishing this stuff, if you have the option, we want to select native shrubs native to that area, because they're going to function properly with those native disturbances like grazing and fire.
That's right.